welcome to a new episode of A Fire Inside Out, our podcast where we're breaking down each and every recording AFI has ever done. I'm your host. I am Ben Hansen, and I'm joined by Jeff Cork.
Hello. When you spell it out like that, it sounds very intimidating.
Doesn't it?
Each and every recording.
But it's not so bad. We've been hitting like main albums up to this point. Now it's going to get a little bit scattered.
It's going to get all EPE.
It's going to get a little bit EPE. So there might be some shorter episodes in the future.
Or do we compile them?
No, I think we keep them separate. I want to go chronologically.
Really? Okay. So yeah. We have not missed any EPs, right?
Well, there have been some really crappy EPs early on where we played like Mini Trucks Suck and some of like the highlights from them.
Okay.
But a lot of those early EPs are just recordings that were on Answer That and Stay Fashionable and a little bit from Very Proud of You.
Okay.
So it's not like we missed too much.
Okay.
But going into the future, some of the best stuff is in EPs, so we can't dodge it.
I can't wait to go to the future.
Oh my God, it's going to be great.
I hope so.
This episode is a beefy one, though. Hope you're prepared to talk.
I am prepared to talk.
All right, we have Shut Your Mouth and Open Your Eyes from 1997.
Is that, and then you'll get a big surprise? Is that how the rest of that
stands? That's right, in the fine print underneath the name. Did you see the album cover for this
one? I wanted to talk about that, first of all.
I don't know what it is.
It looks like it belongs to a completely different band.
Yeah.
And they just put AFI on it. Because it's like an old-timey drawing of a magician, right? And like a guy's kind of floating.
And there's like a demon lying on the ground.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like it's a similar color scheme to like the Very Proud of You album, but it just looks crude. And I'd love to know the story behind it. I have no idea. If anybody knows, please leave it in the comments below.
Yeah.
But
Wikipedia is so far away.
All right. So at this point, shut your mouth and open your eyes. 1997. Davey Havoc is 22 years old.
Oh, man.
Our favorite bassist, Jeff Kresge, has left the band.
He's out of there.
He's completely out. We have a young, up-and-coming hot star named Hunter Bergen.
Oh, gosh. Stage name?
I don't think so.
Oh,
I think he might be a real Hunter. So he's stepping on stage. He is the new bassist. And we still have Mark Stoffeles on guitar here.
Just rolls off the tongue.
Yeah. What were you doing in 1997?
Let me think. I was making my triumphant return to college after taking a couple years off. I told you about that.
No, I don't think so. You were journeying around the world?
Well, here's what happened.
Uh-huh.
This is a cautionary tale.
Sure.
I went to college immediately after high school, as most people do.
Right.
And my second semester, I just totally botched it because Street Fighter 2 came out in the arcades that year, and I just spent most of the semester playing Street Fighter 2, and I got straight D's, and it was pretty terrible. And then a couple years later, I'm working retail, and I'm like, this is really terrible. And I met a girl who was going to college.
Uh-huh.
I was like, I bet if I go to college, she's going to be really impressed. And she was.
Wow. And that changed your life forever.
Yeah.
I mean, if you wouldn't have met that girl, would you have gone back to college?
I would have continued playing Street Fighter 2, I can assure you.
Still to this day,
uh-huh.
Takes several hours out of each day to play Street Fighter 2 in the arcades, which is difficult to do these days.
It really is quite hard.
Who's your character?
Back then it was Chun-Li.
Wow.
Big Chun-Li fan.
I wouldn't expect that. Really? I'm a Dalsim guy myself.
Really?
He reminds me of me.
Flame breathing, extended limbs. God, you're handsome.
All right, so this album, Shut Your Mouth and Open Your Eyes.
Hey, wait.
Yeah.
What were you doing?
Ooh, let's see. 10 years old. I was.
Are you serious?
Yep. I was eagerly anticipating the release of The Lost World, which came out that year. Saw it multiple times in the theaters. Absolutely devoured that movie.
You were 10.
Yeah.
I could have beaten you to death with my fists.
You could have beaten me to death with your looks. I was such a wimpy kid.
Wow.
Which is why
I'm so glad I didn't do that.
Yeah.
Because I would have no one to talk to right now.
Would have been a very, let alone edit the podcast, for Christ's sake.
Oh, God. Wait, this is edited?
It really is edited.
Interesting.
So after the last episode when we did Very Proud of You, we were both a little bit disappointed by Very Proud of You. I think it's fair to say.
Little did we know.
Little did we know. Oh, wait a minute. I'm curious what you're going with that. But I, on the drive home, was like, I got to get a taste for what's coming up next. I remember loving Shut Your Mouth and Open Your Eyes. And so I blasted the first song, Keeping Out of Direct Sunlight, and I was immediately in a great mood.
All right, really?
Yeah, here we go. Keeping Out of Direct Sunlight.
Okay.
This is how it starts. We are the ones only we can recognize. Within the dark side. immediately it sounds so much different. Oh, hang on. It is just a great introduction to this album. Maybe I'm nuts, but it sounds so much different from Very Proud of You too that it just got me so excited for this album.
Yeah, the whole album in general, I think, is completely different from Very Proud of You. So they do.
Yeah.
And I usually like that.
Uh-oh.
But overall, as we'll discuss, this is like a direction I wasn't totally into. It made me look fondly on Very Proud of You.
Wow.
He's like, this is my notes, and I've written this in pen.
Yeah.
This so I'm is not doing this to be a,
sure.
a troublesome jerk.
Uh-huh.
But I wrote, pretty weak start to the album.
Just the first song?
Yeah, because I don't find that We Are the Blank
yeah.
lyric. Anyone who's ever done that, I just find that exceptionally boring. It seems like I wrote, it's a pandering anthem for teenage malcontents.
Well.
Which I guess you could say that about a lot of songs that these guys put out. But this one especially uh-huh. just seems like we're going to pump you up, kids.
Cork, I have really bad news if you're not into pandering anthems because... Welcome to AFI, everybody.
I probably should have seen this coming.
Yeah, you really should have seen this coming. I think this serves as a great introduction, and this really kicks off the overall arc of the group, kind of channeling the group mentality, the communal chants, getting everybody into it. Yeah, mm-hmm. with those lyrics of like, all arise to what we bring, recruiting everybody for a despair-ridden adventure mm-hmm. is the overall tone of this song. And I absolutely loved it. I was so excited about this song. And then how it immediately flows right into Three Seasons, just
oh, that's right a great off. Transition. Yeah.
I love it. I love yep. it. But this like minute introduction song, I think it's a really cool way to start an album.
I like the fact that it's a minute. Well, that's my favorite part about
it. Was it a relief? Like I listened to this album, then went back and listened to Very Proud of You again, mm-hmm. and I was just shocked by how much deeper Davey's voice is this time around.
Oh yeah, and he does a lot more actual singing.
Yeah.
Also, as we'll discuss, also
right.
Yeah, which is good. His voice is deeper, like you said. He seems like he's capable of more yelling.
He became a man.
Yeah.
All right. So next song that it dives right into is called Three Reasons.
This one is one of two, and I'll point out the other one later.
God, yeah.
Everything's going to happen later.
I know.
But totally, to my ears, a very Pixies-inspired guitar opening.
Oh, interesting. All right. Let's hear the beginning here.
Let's hear it.
Yeah, I guess I can see that.
Well, you can hear it.
I guess I can hear it.
Okay, this is where that part ends. Typically not the Pixies.
Yeah. So, as excited as I was about that first song, mm-hmm. then Three Reasons starts, and I realize, like, I think musically it's different enough from Very Proud of You. Mm-hmm. Hang on, this little...
He's singing about dick butt, sideways. I can't talk right now.
Sorry. Yeah, it's a dick butt sideways.
That's what he's saying, right?
Yeah, that he later changes his name to Dick Butt Sideways. But this one, I think lyrically, it just is much more in base or in touch with the Very Proud of You roots
mm-hmm.
than I expected. Like in my mind, it was a pretty clear division between Very Proud of You and Shutting Your Mouth and Open Your Eyes.
Yeah,
but actually reading through the lyrics for this entire album and going through it, it's shocking how similar they are lyrically.
Mm-hmm. It's shocking how similar. Some of these songs are lyrically to songs that appear on this album as well, too.
Okay.
We'll get to that.
It's kind of repeating the same theme.
The same lyrics.
Sure, sure.
So
I think overall, my thoughts on this album mm-hmm. are musically starting mm-hmm. to change things up, which I really, really love, especially some songs, which really stand out.
Yeah.
But thematically, I think it's pretty similar ground,
mm-hmm.
except lyrically, he's getting a little bit more advanced and a little bit more abstract.
Mm-hmm.
So it's getting a little bit darker.
Yeah, he was just inviting us on the despair train, and now it's reality hits home.
Right, right. But this isn't the most amazing start to the actual songs on the album.
No, I think that Three Reasons should have opened the album.
Instead of Keeping Out of Direct Sunlight.
Absolutely.
You are an insane person, because kicking things off with Direct Sunlight is such a great way to introduce the entire album. I just wish the entire album was as diverse mm-hmm. and different sounding from Very Proud of You as Keeping Out of Direct Sunlight is.
Yeah.
But this next tune.
Hey.
Yeah.
Let's talk about this tune one more second.
Yeah.
You wear headphones, right?
All the time, dude.
If you listen carefully, in the left channel at the very beginning,
mm-hmm.
when the little guitar thing's going on, you can hear someone plugging another instrument in.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
You tell me when.
Just listen.
Right about there?
Yeah.
Okay. They're raw, man.
They're very raw.
You can't contain them.
Yeah.
All right. That's Three Reasons. Also, very confusing that they have a song called Three Reasons and mm-hmm. Third Season.
Yeah.
Weird.
And single second. And there's a lot of numbers here.
Yeah, they're a very mathematical band.
000.
That's true.
They're a mathematical band. Like I said, a lot of science.
Their pH is low. Yeah, that's clearly adult, probably a 3.
Yeah.
All right. Okay. Next song, Cork.
Yes.
I'm just going to kick
just
right
kick
into it.
It.
You ready?
Yeah.
Because this is a song that you just need to buckle up for. This is a single second, third mm-hmm. song from Shut Your Mouth and Open Your Eyes. Funky bass intact.
Mm-hmm.
New bassist. A little bit chunkier sounding. All right. With the recording equipment that we have, you cannot hear the backup vocals too well, but that is my favorite part of the song.
You like the backup?
Absolutely.
When the guy's singing in the right channel?
Yes.
You are an insane person.
Holy cow, Cork, we're going to have some differences.
Yeah.
Why? What did it sound like to you?
Garbage.
Garbage.
Yeah. I think if you'd taken that out, the song would have been a lot better. And he only, like, the backup vocal thing. Only happens a couple times in the song, but every time
right.
I was just rolling my eyes like, ugh, get this guy away from the microphone.
Is it because it sounded like a different voice?
It just sounded silly.
Lyrically silly?
It doesn't matter what that guy was saying. He could have had the most badass lyric like,
are you saying
I'm riding
memories
on a flaming horse, and it still would have sounded ridiculous.
You're saying memories dull my senses isn't a badass lyric?
Uh-uh.
So that backup singer that you hate so much.
This is the biggest problem I'm facing in my life right now.
It really is. You never stop talking about it. Yeah. His name is Nick 13.
Nick 13.
Yeah, and he's in a... Don't laugh at him.
God damn it.
He's a majestic man. And you should know him. Actually,
what?
Not really, but you should honor him because he's in a band called Tiger Army. Have you ever heard of them?
Nope.
They're very good. And the bassist, Jeff Kresge, mm-hmm. He joined their band later. So he's a big part of Tiger Army. He played a stand-up bass in that one. Tiger Army and AFI kind of grew up together, had similar paths. There's a lot of crossover between those bands. So this collaboration is kind of a fun thing for fans of both bands.
Okay.
So that backup singer is a big deal, is what I'm trying to say, Cork.
Okay.
One time?
One time?
One time I saw Tiger Army live.
Oh, God.
And it was at the Warp Tour.
Oh, yeah.
And it was a huge crowd.
How much did you pay for water?
Oh, so much. They also sold milk there, so I drank a lot of milk, I remember.
Oh, gross.
And so Tiger Army was playing, and they're playing at like 1:30 in the afternoon. And
it's ideal.
Yeah. And they have a song that's called Power of Moonlight. And so they got up on stage, and then they're like, this song's about the power of moonlight, and I just want to say, fuck that sun in the sky. And he's like pointing, but like the stage was kind of covered, and he was just pointing 100% in the wrong direction because he couldn't see where the sun was. But like I was so far back, it just was the silliest combination of events. Like, yeah, power moonlight, here we go. So
stupid sun,
the worst thing ever created. Yeah. So yeah, Tiger Army, you should definitely check them out if you like old AFI.
Okay.
There's a lot of crossover there, but yeah, Nick 13, and you should remember this song because it is going to come up again much later.
Okay.
I think maybe this is personal taste,
mm-hmm.
but when you think older AFI, this song is kind of a go-to for fans.
Yeah, that's what I liked about it. It seemed like a kind of a return to form after the last couple of songs, which were hit or miss, you know what I mean? I think I like the earlier AFI judging from this album.
Really?
Maybe they go in a different direction.
Yeah, yeah.
Even still, so I'm excited to like continue listening to them.
Sure.
But I like this one. I mean, I like it when Mr. David Havoc sings about like feelings, and he makes it more personal rather than uh-huh. like we are an army of kids who get spit on and all that kind of crap. Because I think it's more interesting than just like F- you mom and jocks and ex friends.
Right.
Because Also made a note.
Yeah.
Seems like sometimes his songwriting has a tendency, kind of, you listen to it and it's like he had to summarize a better song in his own words for a class assignment. Like,
huh. What does that mean exactly?
That means like he heard a really good song and then he had to write down what that song was about,
uh-huh,
without using any of those other words.
So he's kind of, it feels like he's writing around something, like overwriting it, or...
I wouldn't say that's ever been a problem.
Okay. But this song stood out to me lyrically because I think it is the darkest.
Mm-hmm.
So far, like, I raised my eyes up to the light in hopes of finding healing. No relief was mine. I was burnt by the sun. Again, kind of continuing
ceiling,
that...
it should have been.
Oh, that would have made more sense. Yeah. But it is getting a little bit more poetic along the way.
Yeah.
Also, this is a song that stands out to me as getting relatively dark, but seeing Davey live in this time, he's still so excited and so enthusiastic up on stage and so nice.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe that's just that straight edge persona, but that's always, this is the weird dichotomy with AFI, is the lyrics sometimes can be dopey, filled with despair, but then he always just strikes me as the nicest guy and he's super nice to his fans from everything I can see.
See, I think that's awesome.
Right.
He's like having fun, even though you would think he would just be a big jerk on stage.
Yeah.
Like blow a loogie out his nose or something.
Right. Yeah.
I guess that would just be a booger, wouldn't it?
Yeah, just a normal booger. Yeah. He's not really one of those types of guys. He's not spitting into the audience's faces.
Yeah.
Not your typical punk rocker.
Oh, does he hold the mic out sometimes?
All the time. Yeah.
Did he pull it back before that they get a chance to sing? Because that would be a really dirty trick.
That would be pretty punk rock. No, I don't think he's ever done
it's
that.
That's a railroad spike and he sticks it in someone's forehead.
Yeah. So overall, you like this song then?
Yeah. Yeah, okay. Definitely.
It's hardcore enough. So you want hardcore, mm-hmm, and songs about his emotions.
Yeah. I think that the songs that I've liked the most are like that.
Okay.
Yeah.
So next song, PH Low. How does this one stand out to you? Little staircase guitar building, yeah, here.
There's a monster chasing you.
Oh, that's good. This part here,
mm-hmm,
this feels like it could have been on the earlier albums.
Yeah.
I think the chorus gets a little more melodic and starts to separate it a little bit. But overall, this feels like an older style song to me.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. What'd you think of PH Low?
I remember wanting it to just get to the chorus.
Right.
And then
right,
when I got there, I was like, oh, okay. We're here.
I like it. It's coming up here. I think it sounds pretty nice. I think hearing Davey sing this much,
mm-hmm,
really stands out compared to the previous albums.
Yeah.
And that's what separates this track a little bit more.
Yeah, for sure.
But, I mean, the lyrics, again, are basically just, fuck you.
Mm-hmm.
But this is where it starts to separate, and the lyrics are now kind of cushioning the language more about life and death.
Mm-hmm.
And trying to be a little more poetic about the whole thing instead of just literally saying, fuck you, over and over again.
Fuck you, life. I'm sticking with death.
I vote death. Any other thoughts on PH Low?
That one I really had very little to say about it. It's
okay.
Just totally an adequate AFI song.
That's what I call an adequate AFI song.
Yeah.
All right. That's totally fair. So the next song is Let It Be Broke.
Yes.
As Corkyon's.
Midyon. Sorry.
Midyon.
Yes.
All right. So I just want to, I was fascinated by the beginning of Let It Be Broke.
Mm-hmm.
I guess I really didn't remember it that well. The first lyrics that he says, I live in truth complacently.
Hmm.
Those are the words that he's saying. Now let's actually listen to it.
Okay.
The guitar reminds me so much of another song. Here we go. I have no idea how that's what it is. But that is, in theory, I live in truth complacently. It's a relatively fast hardcore song throughout the entire thing. I like the breakdown coming up here.
Yeah.
This is another one lyrically where it's kind of disappointing how traditional it was for AFI.
Mm-hmm.
It was just kind of blaming you, basically changing the lyrics from fuck you to I will defy. And yeah. then he then chants I will defy over and over again. But what's he defying from?
Oh, boy. Where to begin? Conventional names.
Yeah, certainly. This part here is coming up when he has a big scream. It's good. All right, singing a little bit here. All right, Davey. It's coming.
What's real?
Yeah. Do you like this one then? Since you're into the more aggressive AFI?
On this one, I wrote boring to listen to. So, as you can tell, I'm a highly esteemed rock and roll journalist.
you're really tough to please.
But at the same time, I wrote, must have been a real crowd pleaser live.
Yeah.
Is it?
I don't think I ever heard them sing this song live,
uh-huh.
but I would imagine that it would also be a crowd pleaser.
That's a term that rock writers use, right? Crowd pleaser?
Certainly, yeah.
Rock and roll writers?
Nah, you got it, man. You got the vocab.
Yeah, cool.
I like the lyric in this song
mm-hmm.
where he said, it's been so dark for so long now, a new light has come along, illuminating all, so shut your eyes.
Mm, just too much.
But.
It's too much beauty.
Name of the album is Open Your Eyes. Choose a side, Davey. Also, there's more weird eye mouth references later on. I'm mm-hmm. wondering if this is one of those things where they wrote the album, they realized, like, what do we talk about the most in this album? So, yeah, I guess throats and eyes.
It's not shutting your mouth, I can tell you.
All right. Okay, Cork.
All right, here we go. The jackpot.
This is what I call the jackpot.
This, yep.
All right, this is a song.
The titular song of the album.
Called Third Season.
Yep.
Compared, okay, just think of all of Very Proud of You
mm-hmm.
and all of Answer That and Stay Fashionable.
Mm-hmm.
Next album, this is the way the song opens. Singing Davey Havok comes out for the first time in mm-hmm. full fours.
Now listen right here. This is another Pixies guitar.
The guitar? Thing. Yeah, I can see that. I want to know how much this song stood out to you.
It stood out to me because the bass is just playing several songs that are in different keys. None of it.
Oh, really?
It is really hard for me to listen to.
It's Hunter's first time.
Playing the bass? Because it sounds like... Like, every little stanza is out of tune with the previous one?
Really? I never noticed
it's
that.
It's really gross.
You know what has always stood out to me in this
What's
song?
What's that?
Okay, let's jump back.
I like the chanting.
The chanting? This is also a communal
yep.
thing. This is like a big rally song, mm-hmm. but you're in favor of this one?
Yeah, I love chanting and choruses and all that stuff.
Okay, all right.
Well, yeah.
Just not joining for some sort of dark army.
No.
Okay, so listen carefully. Around like minute 03?
Oh, yeah.
There's this weird, this is nitty gritty.
Okay, let's go.
But there's this weird background sound, and I always thought it sounded like a modem, mm-hmm. or is this like an extra hiss? And I hope you can hear it in this recording.
Okay.
This always stood out to me as weird. All right, here we go. Listen up. Right here. In the background, this is it sounds like a modem. It really does.
I didn't hear it.
You can hear it right now. It just kicks in, and I want to know in the recording process what the hell that is. Maybe I should try and call the producer of this album to try and get an answer for what that track is. What the hell's happening?
Yeah, I didn't hear it.
It's super nitty gritty. I'm okay. Sorry. It's really nerdy stuff.
Yeah, only a nerd would hear some weird sound effect.
That's right.
Buried underneath the
guitar. To be fair, I've heard this song a lot. I think this is, I'm going to go ahead and say, this is the first musically great song that AFI has ever made.
Yeah.
If you could work your way chronologically, like Single Second, I think is really aggressive and poppy fun. It's weird to call that song poppy, but it is kind of catchy. And this one, I just love the sound of. I love how varied it is. I love how much it stands out from all of their previous stuff and really this entire album in retrospect.
Yeah, I love the guitar.
Yeah.
So I love the Pixies. And Davey kind of sounds like he's singing like he should be in a cult cover band, kind of. Just, that kind of thing.
Yeah, when he goes, Mother's Love.
Exactly.
Yeah, he loves Danzig, and there's a little bit of Danzig in this
one. Yeah, yeah. But then, I'm telling you, that bass thing.
Yeah.
I had to listen to it several times just to make sure that there wasn't something wrong with my speakers. I had,
really?
Like, multiple headphones.
Here, see if you can point it out here. Right in this part. No.
Well, this sounds great. Going up about a purple flare.
Weird step.
That's a super nitty gritty thing, right?
Yeah, exactly. Hardcore fans may notice. You're insane, Cork. This is a perfect song.
No! This part doesn't have anything wrong with the bass.
Is it in the beginning?
It's the very beginning, yeah.
All right, let's jump back.
Okay, listen to it. This is not the beginning.
The very beginning.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Okay, here we go. Here we go. Just listen to it. I'm telling you, you gotta listen to it. So everything's fine.
Uh-huh.
Sounding pretty great. Here we go.
Can you feel the pulse?
Yeah.
Can you feel the heat rising from below?
Can you can't hear
this
that?
All over the... I don't think I'm musically smart enough to be like, oh, that's out of key with the rest of the music or anything.
It just
like that.
Sounds super gross.
Jeff Kriege wouldn't have done that.
I wouldn't have done that.
By
I
the way,
how to play the bass. I have to say, too, like, to be fair,
yeah.
I know that I've said some things about Mr. David Havoc that might be sounding mean
when
I criticize him. But if I have not, when I was 22, the most interesting things in my life that I had done was I dropped out of college.
Right.
And I drank a lot of liquor. So that's basically the opposite. Well, he dropped out of college.
That's
so we
true.
Have that in common.
Yeah, certainly. He poured out a lot of liquor, just not into his mouth, but like a kitchen sink, I'd imagine.
Oh, yeah. On stage, maybe if someone gave him a drink and they didn't know any better.
Right, right.
He would go, ah, no. So anyway, you have to respect that. Someone who's like that young, who's like going on stage, I would have been so mortified.
This is getting into dangerous territory, Cork, for you to suddenly be in the ground of like, you know what? You just have to respect them for trying, right? They're going out there,
point.
They're doing it.
Oh, he does some stuff that is just embarrassing to listen to.
Okay.
But at the same time, if I was in a band at that age, it would have been really awful to listen to now.
Is there an album that stands out for you musically where you just can't believe that the band that young produced that? I always think of like Lonesome Crowded West from Modest Mouse, which is, I love that album.
Mm-hmm.
And then you go look at footage of them and there's like, holy crap, they're like 20-year-old kids.
Yeah.
And in interviews, they just strike me as so stupid and they produce such an amazing, bizarre album.
Yeah.
But it is weird just to think about how dark this album gets. And it's like, oh, Davey Havoc's 22.
Mm-hmm.
But he already found his inner despair. Clearly something traumatic happened to him. I don't know if he...
His best bud betrayed him.
That's right. But his best bud betrayed him and then he saw like a shadow that looked like a demon. On the wall once.
Yeah.
But this is actually third season from the title and also in the song itself. First time they really started experimenting with like the fall imagery,
mm-hmm.
you know, waiting for the seasons to change, all that stuff. And that's going to be a big part of AFI for a little while now.
Yeah.
Is kind of that pumpkin fall aesthetic. Which is
pumpkin fall.
The pumpkin fall aesthetic. You'll understand later.
Yeah. Can we talk about the music video?
Yeah. This is their second music video then.
This is not a Reservoir Dogs kind of thing, or a Goodfellas kind of thing, rather.
I don't know what kind of thing this is. Lay it out, Cork.
All right. So it starts off. There's a kid in the suburbs, and they're skateboarding and stuff. And the band, AFI, cool-looking dudes, are sitting on a stoop.
Just hanging out.
But they've been considerate enough to leave a little space for Davey.
Mm-hmm.
And he comes out of the front door and sits down.
They're all wearing all black, taking themselves very seriously.
Yeah, they have little pompadours and stuff. they sit there,
uh-huh.
and the kids are doing stuff. You don't know what they're doing. And then the song starts, and like Davey starts singing, but he's lip syncing. It is the most cringe-inducing thing I've seen in a long time because his bandmates don't have instruments, so they're forced to just sit right next to their buddy, and he's like earnestly lip syncing.
Right.
And like the drummer, he can't even like pat himself on the thighs, you know, to keep the beat. And then when they do the chorus and the chant, they all do
and then go back immediately to not saying anything.
Right. But this is a music video though. So what's happening is a spooky ice cream truck.
Sweet Tooth, basically.
Yeah, comes into town. And the kid that we saw in the beginning tries to buy ice cream. Not enough money. He gives a signal to his friends who are like lurking in the shadows.
Right.
They come over and just smash the shit out of the ice cream truck. And one of them dumps the tray of ice cream into the crowd. And people are punching the sides and breaking headlights.
And then they each grab a limb of the ice cream truck driver and just rip them apart.
Oh, yeah.
No, that doesn't happen. That would make it more interesting.
Yeah.
This is... First of all, I feel sorry for that truck driver. Like, they make him seem like a monster, but really he's just explaining, hey, you need $2 to buy this ice cream, and you only have $1.
Yeah.
I'm not a bad guy. Yeah, I'm just charging a price for this ice cream.
Yeah, the kid, like, he, like, tries to do it again, like, hey, I've only got a buck.
Right.
It's like, you don't have any ice cream yet. That's just the way this works.
This is one of those things where I feel like the director recorded the band looking cool on the stoop, and they're like, then when they got to recording, the band's like, so what are you going to be cutting this in with? Like, what's the other B-roll you're using? He's like, don't worry about it. It's just because like a relatively serious hardcore song about, you know, getting your sweet patience and revenge.
Uh-huh.
And then it's just shots of a kid dumping ice cream onto like other 8-year-olds.
And are we to believe that the band AFI are just watching all this unfold from their suburban house? Like, they all live together.
Well, that explains that close-up shot of them licking their lips, looking at the ice cream in the street.
He can't stop licking his lips.
It's a weird music. I remember it being cool, but now, man, it just stands out as bizarre. And it's like, part of me likes it because it's like, okay, it's a fairly hardcore song, but it shows that AFI doesn't take themselves that seriously at this point because it is such a stupid premise. Like, it's not that far away from Cereal Wars.
Right. You remember the first video, though, was pretty weak.
But and at least that one was, like, hardcore.
Well, listen, we thought, well, maybe that was directed by, like, a friend who had access to equipment and stuff.
Right.
I think what happened here is that same friend, you know, went to film school, took a few classes, and he's like, you know what? This is kind of symbolic of an uprising. You know, you're sitting on a step. We don't have the budget to show like a war.
Right.
And that's gross. So let's do an ice cream truck.
That's similar second to greatest uprising ever to take place.
Yeah. It's pretty great video.
I would love to find that kid now. If you're that kid from the third season video and you're listening to this podcast, please tweet me at Yozetti.
You have to be able to prove it. Also.
Yeah. Yeah. We need photos of you eating ice cream at Davy Havoc.
Exactly.
All right. Moving on to...
Let's move on.
The next song, Lower Your Head and Take It in the Body.
Hmm.
Clearly, he became a boxing fan at some point here. Here's Lower Your Head. I like this song because instead of tearing other people down, it's basically him pumping himself up and talking about how great he is.
And it's got that guy who keeps going, yeah!
In the background, which could be because a guy named Jade Puget sang backup vocals on this album. And I don't know exactly where, but later on he's going to be joining the band.
Really?
So I don't know exactly which songs it was on.
So he left quite an impression on the group.
That's right.
That guy can do a yeah like no one else. Possibly.
Yeah, he was in the back of the ice cream truck, I think. All right, yeah, it's not a great song. The most interesting part's coming up here, and it's even not that great. The breakdown's always proven to be the most interesting part, even on a mediocre song.
Yeah.
And it's coming up pretty soon here.
So who's slapping Davy Havoc?
Who's slapping him around?
Yeah.
Maybe just society is what I'd be led to believe. He doesn't really have a lot of songs about being abused by a parent or an uncle or anything like that.
And like you said, this is a song about boxing, right?
I don't think that's literal.
What is it? What is this song
I think
about?
It's about a song about being pushed around in society, that type of thing. Yeah, you know,
I don't understand lowering your head and taking it in the body, what that refers to.
Maybe.
Because if that is a boxing strategy, that seems like a terrible idea unless you want to get punched in the face.
Yeah, that's really true. So maybe lowering your head, taking it to the body is more about stop thinking about it and take it in your heart, his heart that's being drowned in flames, as the lyrics leads you to believe.
God. I don't get it.
Okay. Next song. It's just about returning coins. We have Coin Return. I do like the intro to the song. His first line, I've slipped and I have fallen. This is probably the most rockin' song on the album, kind of the heaviest one overall.
Mm-hmm.
It gets into some good screaming later on, and then there's a weird breakdown later on in the song. I don't know if it stood out to you, too.
Yeah, and it's got some slapping in that one, too.
The lyrics about being slapped around?
Yeah.
Slapping the bass?
Slapping around.
Just slapping around. Yeah, there's that one song off Very Proud of You that I remember saying, like, oh, this is like the closest that AFI ever comes to rapping.
Mm-hmm.
But this one actually gives it a run for its money, where he's trying to like squeeze words into the rhythm that clearly wasn't meant to be.
Right.
It's coming up here. Recall, stop me in my face. There we go. Every time I fall, what's not? Disregard with each new fall. Why hit twice as hard? What can I? Disregard with each new fall. Why hit twice as hard? There we go. This one also, yeah. Very boxing heavy song if you want to look at it that way.
I like it when he talks about he cannot disregard. What a strange thing to sing about.
It's easy to rhyme with disregard
and hard
with it. Yeah. It definitely works out. It's interesting. It kind of descends into just pretty hardcore screaming by the end of it.
Mm-hmm.
But the lyrics actually turn a little bit sweet.
Yeah.
Well, I guess you can see it as one-sided sweet, but it's like, would you be there for me? I would. I would be there for you. I would. Would you look up to see? I would. I don't know if that's sweet or just kind of bitter.
Is that
more of like
S-E-E or S-E-A?
Oh, S-E-A.
Okay.
Yeah, more about just I'm better than you, I guess, overall.
Ah.
One of those themes. I don't know if you've heard that in From AFI before.
He's pretty much the best.
Yeah. This next song?
Yeah.
Really stands out. The new patron saints and angels as the first kind of sweet song from AFI.
Yeah.
Where lyrically it's all about complimenting somebody, which is new ground for them. So here's this one.
I love the pick slide.
It's good. I like the way he sings that. So I admire the way you shine. The lyrics there. It's all just one elaborate compliment. Would you like to hear the lyrics, Cork?
Let's hear the lyrics.
I've seen the light that emanates from you, and it makes me feel proud. A voice of reason above the muffling crowds. Such will to live, and you've got so much to give. Long lost sincerity. Lost in a world that's been scorched to black. Lost in myself until I finally find a guide in you, and gratitude is mine. I admire the way you shine. It's strangely sweet.
Yeah.
You'd never expect it.
A little patronizing at the beginning, but it's very sweet.
Yeah, you know how it goes. So there is a weird breakdown right here.
Uh-huh.
Where it gets a little repetitive with the guitar. It stands out as weird.
Oh, yeah.
Hang it. It'll cut out, and it's just going to be the guitar then. He's looking around at the rest of the band. What do I do? What's going on? Stall.
When I heard that part,
yeah,
I imagine that like a lot of teens driving with their dad in the car put this album into like kind of make him feel weird and everything. And
sure,
I bet
the
dads were like, huh, what's wrong with this song? It seems like is your disc dirty? A lot of dad jokes kind of
stuff.
I can
see dad jokes. Yeah. I certainly played AFI for my dad, and he did not. He was not a fan.
Not into that.
It's like, hey, how about we go back to that Nirvana Unplugged? Not so bad. Go. Yeah, so it's interesting if you listen to like early FI, a lot of people just say like, oh, all the songs are exactly the same.
Nope.
Would you say that, Cork?
I would not say that.
Okay, but this one definitely stands out. For like, if you actually read the lyrics, it stands out so much more compared to the rest.
Mm-hmm.
Musically, Third Season stands out on this album, and lyrically, New Patron Saints and Angels stands out just for being so sweet overall. Yeah. Okay. Now we're getting to the first Stump song.
Salt for Your Wounds.
Oh, no, 3 Seconds Notice.
Oh, yeah. I'm skipping ahead.
Yeah, don't skip ahead, man. We cannot forget this
totally
little
blew it.
This little dandy. This one.
This sounds like it could have fit on the last album.
3 Seconds Notice? Yeah, there's a couple that are just stupid enough mm-hmm. that they could have fit there.
Yeah.
Here we go. This is 3 Seconds Notice. Cork, you should know that this is the song that ends our podcast.
Really?
Yeah.
I wonder why.
I don't know what part of the song I would use to end the podcast, but here we go. Enjoy 3 Seconds Notice.
Another song where he's talking about people spitting in his face.
Yeah.
When was the last time you spat in somebody's face?
I spat in my dad's face when I was in high school.
Did you really?
I feel like I've talked about my dad a lot. Maybe this is becoming more cathartic than I imagined.
Dad talk.
We get along super well, but that was like, that was probably the biggest confrontation I ever had with my dad. Is it was half done jokingly, but he was being a dick about something, mm-hmm. and I was in high school.
There you go.
And so I just like spat in his face. I think it was, you know, in my mind, it was like 40% for just the absurdity of it. Mm-hmm. And he fucking hated it.
Yeah, he was naturally not into getting spit on.
Yeah, he was pretty uptight. You know, he is, you know, those old timers. Yeah. But like, he didn't scream. He was just like, what the fuck? And then I think like the next day he talked about it, which like, that was insanely rude. Yeah. Like, I can't believe that happened.
I think I would have decked you.
Really? Do you think you would have?
Yeah.
It's a super fair reflex.
Yeah.
But so I think I know. I think my dad knows how Davey Havoc feels.
I don't know if this technically counts. I was riding a bus in elementary school with a kid named Larry. And I was talking and he spit right in my mouth as I was talking. It was pretty impressive, but also just the grossest.
Ugh. It does sound terrible.
Yeah, it was gross. Yuck.
So 3 Seconds Notice. It feels like a weird joke song out of the blue.
He quits.
He quits with 3 Seconds Notice. And then the song ends, of course, with him singing I Quit Again. But like, it's not musically a great song.
No.
I can't imagine it be that fun to sing live.
But I bet the I quit part, people lose their minds, right?
And then they all like sit perfectly still as like before that like, kicks back in afterwards.
Yeah.
Yeah, maybe that'd be fun. But just like it strikes me as one of those songs where it's like, why include it on this album?
Mm-hmm.
It's like, especially for an album that starts out so strong, in my opinion, unlike yours.
Yeah.
Why just throw this dumb joke song back in the mix? We should be beyond joke songs at this point with AFI.
So read some of the lyrics. Like,
oh yeah, sure. Why is he quitting?
Why is this a joke song?
Oh, just for that structure of I quit and holding that as long as he can.
Yeah.
And then stopping. That's what I consider a joke song.
Okay.
All right. So 3 Seconds Notice.
Well, this is a band that also has a song about cereal.
Yeah.
So their sense of humor is all over
right.
the place.
I don't know. Maybe it's incorrect to think of it as a joke song. Just kind of a novelty song, I guess, maybe a better way of phrasing it. But Submission, My Back Hurts from Bowing Down.
Mm.
Attraction, Was Once So Strong, Now Can't Be Found. Affection, One Gift I Wish You Would Return. Frustration, As I Accede? Is that a word?
Mm-hmm.
I Do Not Deserve Your Frigidness, Such Callousness, Yet I Persist. What's Wrong With Me? I Told You, You Can't Be Replaced. You Showed Me I'm Just Disposable.
Mm.
Spit In My Face As I Submit. Compliment My Bank Account As I Submit. No, that was a Comedy Bang Bang reference. Spit In My Face As I Submit, So I Quit.
So he's calling someone out for their frigidness.
Right.
But isn't this the man who said, I don't want to fuck you, so fuck you.
But that was about probably groupies, and this is theoretically about his lover. Although, yeah, I can't imagine he's a very affectionate guy overall.
No.
I don't know about the asexual thing. I read an article in Wired over the weekend.
Well, when we get him on the podcast, we'll ask all those questions.
All about his sexuality? That would be fantastic. I would really love it if I could talk to Davey Havoc just about sex. I would be fascinated by
really?
It. Oh, it'd be great. But do you know about this asexuality movement and demisexuality?
What's the movement?
The movement is the idea that people using asexual as an orientation. instead of just as
like
a description.
They're able to reproduce like earthworms?
That's right. No, but just people who just grow up and they're like, yeah, I just don't have much of a sex drive. I just don't want to have sex. It's not an interest of mine. And I guess there is a large group, I forget the actual stats, of people that self-identify as their sexual orientation as just asexual or demisexual, which means rarely having sex or wanting to have sex. Uh-huh. It was an interesting article in Wired. I recommend checking it out.
Yeah, it sounds fascinating. I don't know what you want from me there. All right.
All right. There we go.
I think that if you define yourself by what you're not doing, that's pretty awesome.
You can go into so many different routes. I'm not
a sports fan.
Yep. I'm not a flying person.
I'm not a lifting a refrigerator on my back guy. That's big movement.
I'm not currently underwater.
No.
And I like to define myself by that state.
Yep. I have zero superpowers up to and including teleportation.
All right. Next song is...
I hope we didn't offend anyone.
Yeah. I love asexuality. Yeah. Cool. All right. Next song is Salt for Your Wounds.
God, I was so excited to talk about this and now I got nothing.
Oh, really? Do you have any thoughts? Opening lyrics a little bit preachy. Another, just kind of dumb.
It's pretty preachy, but at the same time, he's talking about feelings. Love
That's true.
Ran out of his heart.
There's a tear in my heart where love ran out.
Yeah.
What's interesting to me is, yeah, he's basically complaining about one person again. Put my faith in you. But then at the end, he changes it to them.
Yeah, and it's I wrote that down too. It's like they twisted the knife further in. Yeah, who's the they?
Yeah, it makes it maybe it's like one person who left the band, Jeff, and then he joined another band. And so this is about hating that person that left and then hating the band that he joined, or somehow that one person then joined a group. I don't think there's actually bad blood between them and Jeff. I mean, later they collaborated, and I guess he sang backup vocals for Sing the Sorrow, which is coming up later, yeah. Everything like that. But this song, there's nothing really too spectacular except for...
It's got a little guitar solo in there, which is always fun to hear.
It does change speed here, which I do love. This is a weird sound for AFI. This weird, chunky guitar.
I like this guitar solo a lot.
It's a good guitar solo. It sounds weird for AFI, but it's the guitarist's last stand, so let him go all out. It is his last time recording an AFI album.
Really?
I think so, unless he's on the next EP.
Guitarist and the bassist both said, enough of this.
Yeah, something led him away. I don't know exactly what it is.
Yeah.
I'd love to get that story. All right, that's Salt for Your Wounds. I'm not too crazy about it.
Yeah.
Moving on.
We have today's lesson.
What is today's lesson?
Well, like? Let me tell you.
Yeah.
Well, the lesson for today,
yeah,
and I followed the instructions. You have to follow these instructions.
Right.
Listen real fucking good. And I tried. I don't know what the lesson is, except for he sings about kissing someone.
Ow. Although, to be fair, this is a cover of a Filth song.
Which oh,
is
never mind.
Band from like 1989 to 1991. Oh, so it's a bit of a throwback
old.
Even
Unbelievable.
Then. Unbelievably old. All right. But let's listen to the interesting intro for today's lesson.
Here's your lesson for today!
Oh my
god. Better lesson on the real f***ing good! My mom promised I was through my fighting! What's up everything?
His singing definitely sounds like he's trying to imitate Filth instead of kind of giving it his own flavor. A little more raspy.
I don't know anything about Filth.
I listened to the song and it sounds a little bit more like this, but this song always stood out to me as just bizarre.
Yeah.
It's okay though, it's kind of fun, it's quick enough. It's pretty forgettable overall.
Mm-hmm.
I like that, like, the lyrics, I mean, are just basically F you again. I mean, they even say that by the end.
Yeah.
But it's like, it's weird to go out of your way to cover a song that certainly sounds like you could have written it yourself. He should have taken your tactic of actually rewriting the lyrics to today's lesson. But I'm sure he really wanted to do that intro because that would be a fun one to kick into live.
Yeah. Maybe he could have just covered it live and maybe left this one off the album.
Yes.
A little treat for fans.
That is certainly a strategy that he could have done.
Who likes Filth? Nobody responds.
All right. Next song
Devil... Very provocatively titled song.
It's called The Devil Loves You.
Mm, this I know.
Some demonic imagery coming out in the title of this one.
Also on the cover. It all kind of loops
on
back.
The cover, yeah. It's like they're getting into a certain something here. Mm-hmm. Devil Loves You, I think, is the worst song on the album.
It sounds like,
yeah.
Before you start, where like he's a little shout chorus thing.
Yeah.
It sounds like he is doing like a morph of, it starts with rocking chair, and then it turns into I Could Care as he goes, every time he says it, like listen to it with that
very
in mind.
Subtly slipping in a rocking chair reference.
Yeah, starting with rocking
all right,
chair.
Here we go.
Yeah, changes.
Yeah,
it's more pronounced, like, the second or third time he does it. It made me laugh, which I guess is good for
That's
something.
All you need. Yeah, this is definitely one of those songs where I would appreciate so much more if it was just about rocking chairs. I think it'd be a little bit deeper.
Yeah.
He's screaming at somebody, yelling at them because they accuse him of being out of touch. He doesn't think he's out of touch. They're out of touch.
Yeah, that's the perfect rejoinder there.
Yeah. So, like, there's that dumb chorus, I couldn't care, I couldn't care. Mm-hmm. And then he gets into it later here where he actually starts singing the chorus himself instead of the backup band.
Sailing supplies.
That's beautiful. Rocking chair more.
Yep.
Yeah. It's so the entire song, it's accusing somebody or asking them questions about what they think about him.
Mm-hmm.
And then like the last paragraph of the song, he starts questioning himself, or like the last line is like, am I completely alone? Just like this weird question, like about himself after an entire song of accusing somebody else or like riddling them with questions. It's not great. Musically, it sounds like butt.
I guess what else needs to be said? I agree with you.
Okay, good. Hansen. Would you agree? Worst song on the album?
Yeah.
Okay,
it's
good.
Yeah, probably. It's offensively bad.
All right. Triple Zero.
Mm-hmm.
I think it always flies underneath my radar a little bit too much. I think it's, they close out the album with it,
mm-hmm.
the conventional album at least, and I think it's one of my favorites on the album.
This is my favorite song on the album.
Oh, really? Oh, yeah. Great. All right, let's take a listen. There he's singing about his eyes and throat burning again. It's a fun swingy song.
Mm-hmm.
For the lyrics about embracing your hate.
Yeah.
Basically sounded like the Star Wars Emperor just like singing a little punk rock song.
And then like I was super happy because it's like, I don't think you're gonna do a breakdown or tempo change here.
Oh really?
This is gonna be it. And then they do it and I was like, ah crap.
Yeah,
but then they got back on track again. And
Do you like the breakdowns?
Sometimes I do. Like this one I was like hoping they wouldn't do it. And there was a spot where I thought, oh no, he's really gonna do it. He's going to rap.
Oh, really?
It sounds
in the
like
breakdown?
This one, because it goes on for a while.
Yeah.
And he doesn't, thank God.
Let's break it on down here. D.
My name's Davey Havoc. I'm here to say.
It's getting too slow. Getting funky. This section is as trippy as AFI ever gets.
Yeah.
It's kind of psychedelic sounding. Like this whole part, like, come on, man. Hey, it's almost as if it's AFI and we're building back into a little drum solo and then going back into the chorus of Triple Zero.
It's a lot like that.
So what made this song stand out to you so much?
I just like the chorus.
Yeah.
I think it's just super catchy.
Yeah.
Yeah, I like it.
It
reminds me of the final song of the last album.
Yeah.
It was just kind of like a fun...
Right.
Like as close as they get to like poppy.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, for a song that sounds so fun, it is amazing like how dark the lyrics are.
Yeah.
So here we go. If you want me to read them aloud.
I would love it.
I think they'd go a little something like this. It burns, it burns, it burns my eyes and throat, but I need no antidote. Gnawing and tearing at my inside, seething, keeping me alive. Hatred poisons me through and through, a sustenance keeping me true. It's not too late. It's never going to be too late. Embrace your hate. The pain, it crushes me. I gain animosity.
Animosity?
It's time for animosity. Acid sweat and bloody tears. Mm-hmm. Through it all, I persevere. Some sedate through indifference, but I withheld zero tolerance.
God, what a good rhyme.
But it's like, it's weird lyrics to shoehorn into an overall pretty fun song. Like, you've heard it at a concert, you would just be smiling.
Yeah.
And that is, again, that weird split of AFI.
Yeah. I miss so much of this band because, honestly, I cannot tell what he's singing about
most
of the time.
Do you look up the lyrics, then?
No. Okay. That's why I like going into this with... full ignorance still, even after having listened to these songs multiple times, because then you can explain things and it's illuminating.
Now you can hear it in a whole new light. Yeah, I normally, first time through, I'll listen to an album and have the lyrics side by side on my computer, and I'll kind of take notes that way, and then I'll listen to it a couple times afterwards, get the lyrics out of my head.
Do that with new albums or just AFI?
No, just AFI. Okay, like albums that really, I really, really like.
Thing
yeah, sometimes, do you ever just like read lyrics as like poetry?
Like without listening to the album?
Yeah, yeah.
I'll listen to lyric or read lyrics to like crack a code. Like, I cannot tell what is being sung here.
Right, right.
That was what was so awesome about CDs when they came out, is they typically had lyrics in them when cassettes did not.
Right. I like that often. You say that. That was what's so awesome about CDs back when they came out.
Yeah.
It changed the world.
I apologize that I was born when I was.
You fucking idiot.
You know, here's an observation. I think unsung hero for this band.
Mm-hmm.
The drummer is fantastic.
Yeah. Adam Carson is his name.
He's been there from the beginning?
Yeah, for sure.
And you could tell he's like improving with each album.
Getting a little more complex.
Yeah. And he's kind of the glue that keeps it together.
Yeah. I was listening or watching an interview with him where he's just kind of backstage at a show being interviewed. And he was talking about listening to the older albums. And he said that there are a lot of songs that he'll listen to and be like, I have no idea how I did that. I don't know what I was doing. I don't remember doing that. And so when people want AFI to play older stuff, a lot of the times it's just like, I just don't even know how. Mm-hmm. I was overthinking it at the time, apparently. And I wouldn't say it gets simpler as it goes on, but yeah, it definitely stands out. On this album in particular, there's a couple of really great drum solos.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Yeah. So there's one more song. This is on the vinyl version.
Oh.
But it is a cover, and I'm curious. I think this is a well-known song. I'm curious. I'm sure you've heard it.
Okay, we'll find out.
Okay, do you want me to tell you what it is?
What's the title of the song?
Last Caress?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Course. Everybody knows Last Caress? All right, here we go. Misfits cover. I guess it kind of fits in the tradition of a kind of fun, swingy song with super dark lyrics. I actually just heard this song live at the First Ave. They have like a WrestlePalooza thing here in Minneapolis. And they had a band up there that is called Metalliger, where it's a band and the main singer. They only cover Metallica songs, and the main singer is dressed as Gallagher. And so in between songs, he'll like smash watermelons and tell super corny jokes. And he'll like stop Metallica songs in the middle and be like, you know... Why do they call them apartments if they're all stuck together?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
And since Metallica covered Last Caress, they ended up covering Last Caress as well.
Interesting. What version do you prefer?
Well, I heard this version first.
Okay.
So I'd have to go AFI, I guess. I'm sure the Misfits is the best version. Do you enjoy the Metallica one more?
Yeah. This is Bus Talk episode. This kid named Jake always brought a boombox on the bus.
Uh-huh.
In junior high.
Sure.
And he really liked Metallica, so I heard a lot of Metallica.
And you heard the Last Crest cover from that?
Oh, yeah, so many times.
And I was like, that'd be pretty edgy, like hearing a song about rape.
Yeah.
On the bus.
Yeah, I don't think a lot of parents would have been super into that.
Yeah, they probably weren't a big fan. I remember the song stood out because there was an edit of it, or like a little montage with the anime One Piece. I remember downloading it from Kazaa and watching it 1,000 times with Last Caress. So whenever I think of One Piece, I always think of Last Caress.
Mm.
Just for a little fun.
How many times a day do you think of One Piece?
Oh my gosh. Well, every time I look at your onesie that you wear around the office, I can't help but think about
it. That old thing.
All right. So overall, Cork.
Yeah.
I feel like I hyped up Shut Your Mouth and Open Your Eyes a
little
bit.
Well, here's the thing, though.
Yeah.
You said, yeah, I re-listened to this album and I don't want to get into it, but I feel very strongly about it.
Yeah.
I thought you were going to like plug your nose and give the old thumbs down.
No, because at that point when I told you that, it's when I just listened to the beginning, basically up to third season.
Mm-hmm.
And even though I think there are some kind of weak songs in that batch, like I think the first track is so awesome, gets me in the mood for a little AFI lovin', and then third season and single second just knocks it out of the park for me.
Yeah.
And so I love the first half of this album altogether. Listening to it overall, it was a little bit underwhelming.
Mm-hmm.
Like I said, lyrically, I think it's a lot closer thematically to Very Proud of You than I expected, but it's just Davey getting a little bit more abstract in his imagery, a little bit darker, a little bit more demonic, but still sticking with fuck you themes and we should band together and fight society themes.
So you talked about this band going in a really crazy direction. Well, do they become a devil band?
A devil band?
Yeah.
I don't want to spoil anything. I don't know if I said crazy direction. I think they have an interesting trajectory.
You may have used the word totally bonkers.
The craziest thing I've ever heard in my life.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true. Well, we'll find out. Next full album is Black Sails in the Sunset.
Mm.
It's not my personal favorite.
Oh.
That one comes after that.
It's about pirates.
It's largely about pirates. I hope you like hearing Davey say R over and over again.
Oh,
he has that whole pirate accent throughout all of his screaming. You can barely tell, though.
Yeah.
No, but it's a lot of AFI fans, hardcore early AFI fans. Black Sails is their favorite album.
Interesting.
Yeah, I think it's really, really good. But the good news is that we're not listening to that next.
Oh.
Next up is a Fire Inside EP, which will be almost like a quick little bonus episode.
Okay.
It's only like four tracks long. Two of them are covers.
Mm.
Yeah, so it should be an interesting evolution. But that is what they released in 1998. But I'm curious, with this album overall, how do you think it stacked up to their previous stuff?
Like, the good songs are really good.
And mainly that's Triple Zero for you?
Triple Zero and...
Third Season, did you like that much?
Third Season
was okay. The music video?
Yeah. I mean, it's a catchy song.
Did Single Second stand out as much as I think it should? That's the one with the vocalist you didn't like, Nick 13.
Oh, yeah, it was all right.
Single Seconds, all right.
Yeah.
Now I've heard everything. So it didn't really stand out, but so Third Season and Triple Zero stand out for you.
There are definitely songs where I make my ultimate AFI mega mix.
Yeah.
There are definitely songs from this album that will make the cut.
Okay, yeah. I would certainly hope so. This album was kind of frustrating listening to again just because, like, just cut a couple of the tracks, man.
Yeah.
A couple of those towards the end.
Yeah.
Just Devil Loves You and what is the other one? 3 Seconds Notice. Just cut it. No one wants it.
Put it on the EP.
Yeah, why not? You released plenty of EPs. Just put that crap out there.
Yeah.
This.
Put it on vinyl.
Certainly. Put Last Caress on there. It's a great cover. Single Second, you could have put on there 7 times. I wouldn't have complained, really.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. If you had to review this one, Cork.
Oh, boy. You kind of got me with my pants down, and I didn't really think about this.
Yeah.
The ultimate number.
Yeah.
I'm going to go 6.5. Yeah.
All right.
What do you
got? I think I'm going to go with 7.
Oh.
Which is disappointing. I really thought it was higher, but just the certain tracks stood out to me so much. But that is Shut Your Mouth and Open Your Eyes, everybody.
Mm-hmm.
Tune in next time for a quick episode on a Fire Inside EP.
It sounds like a joke.
Nope, it is not a joke. Although there's one track on there that you might consider a joke because it is probably the dumbest song. When I told my friend that we were doing an AFI podcast and covering all their tracks, he immediately asked, are you going to do that one track?
The like, one track, the Rainbow Connection
cover? I wish it was Rainbow Connection. No, it is incredibly stupid. So I'm excited to talk about that one. And be sure to tune in next week for the next episode of A Fire Inside Out. AFI.
Bye.
Bye-bye.